DA, how are you, man?
I am great. How you doing?
Doing well. Excited for a big few weeks here.
So tell me, what's your preparation layers-wise for the sideline on Sunday?
Oh, you always come out of the gate with the hard-hitting questions.
I know.
Look, man, there's a few things I feel confident about, but one of them is my preparation when it comes to the elements, something I learned early on in this sideline business. So, yes, layers are critical, but you don't want to be bulky. You still want to be nimble. So I will say we'll have multiple tights. Not sure if I'm going to go snow pants or corduroys. That's going to be a game-time decision. We'll bring both options to the field. A few down thin layers and then a heavy overcoat. But the big question, DA, really, and it was brought to my attention by Tracy Wolfson this morning. This is my first game with this crew, big stage. Do I wear a hat and cover up the hair, or do I brave it and let the lettuce flow?
That's a great question. I have my own previous experience as a sideline reporter in the MLS for the New England Revolution, and in Foxborough, early season, March or late season, November can be brutal. I would go, this is what I would do. I used to go head, ear muffs. But
ooh,
not,
wow.
So the hair, the lettuce flow, but you cover up the ears to keep you a little bit warm. But I don't know if you've got to hear somebody through that, if you can put the little wire
in
there.
Yeah, and look, man, you're a man of style, I think. That's right. That's really a stretch there for me, because I think that's part of the whole packet. I mean, the ears are part of the face, I think you go one way or the other. But these are all really critical points when we talk about this matchup.
You know, being at Arrowhead Stadium on the sideline, it is ridiculously loud. The crowd is close. The fans are built close to the field. So there's a huge advantage that comes out of that when the Chiefs are playing well. And on that point, the defense has played better at home, much better than home, than they have on the road. Do you think that we'll see another solid Chiefs defensive effort like we did last week at home against the Colts, a team that was so maligned for its defense this season?
Yeah, look, I think it's a great point, because as much as we've talked about the weather, whether it be the outfit of sideline reporters or how it's going to affect the players in the game on the field, I think the noise is going to be more impactful than conditions. Because to be honest with you, these sidelines, they have so many heaters that at times these guys may be sweating when they're not out on the field. But it's really loud. The last time the Patriots were there in 2014, we know about that game, it was, I think they set the world record. So to your point, I think this defense really will benefit from that, and I think even more than the noise, too. They've settled in terms of chemistry. They've got Justin Houston back. They've got Daniel Sorensen back. They might get Barry back, it looks like, for this game. So they've kind of found themselves and have a little bit more continuity than I think they had to begin the year. It's still not a great unit by any means, but I think that in terms of chemistry, continuity, that's a benefit. And then, yes, the crowd noise will help, because if you look at New England, their identity to me, which has been sort of an emerging question the entire season, is rooted in the run game. And the run game has been much better at home than it's been on the road. And I don't know, and I'll ask Tom about this when we see him on Saturday, is that because this offensive line and they can't make as many checks at the line because of noise and hasn't been able to get the ball as quick, if that's contributed to that, and that would be huge come Sunday evening.
Evan Washburn's going to be handling some of the sideline duties for the NFL on CBS, the AFC Championship game coming up on Sunday from Arrowhead Stadium. I want to know about Andy Reid, because Andy Reid is a brilliant offensive mind, but I don't think he's wired like normal coaches. I could be wrong on this. It feels like he's less do or die about every game. It seems like he's a little bit more socially normal than most crazy coaches. What's been your experience talking to Reid, and what's your thumbnail on his personality?
That's an interesting take. I will say this. We've had him a few times over the years, and by no means would I say I've gotten to know him, but my take in those short windows has been that he's a guy that is obsessed with football. I mean, there is no doubt it seems to be at his happiest in a film room, on a whiteboard. Those sessions with his offensive staff have become legendary, even going back to his Green Bay days with John Gruden, who told a great story about how they had this massive whiteboard, almost like a Beautiful Mind, if you think back to that movie, just drawing up plays. So I think that's where his obsession lies. When it comes to his personality, he's got a very subtle sense of humor that I find endearing and interesting, but he's very guarded as well. I mean, he's not the kind of guy that comes into our production meetings, kicks up his feet, and opens up to the world. So you kind of use that as a way to kind of build a personality, at least when it comes to what we get on our level of things, which I think is a bit deeper than maybe what you get at a press conference. But to me, he is like a lot of coaches and like his counterpart on Sunday, Bill Belichick, who I know he's friends with, and they really respect each other. There's an obsession with the game of football, and for him specifically, offense, that I think is probably second to none in terms of current coaching.
So maybe I have a wrong read on this. I feel like I could walk into a sports bar in Kansas City and sit down next to Andy Reid and eat wings and drink a beer, and he would talk football with me. I think if I sat down in Boston next to Bill Belichick, he would probably dump soup on my head. And maybe this is because also the assistant coaches that have come out of both, the guys that have come out of the Patriots have been jerks, and the guys that have come out of the Chiefs or the Eagles have seemed like normal guys, like Doug Peterson, like Matt Nagy. It has just felt like they're normal human beings. But maybe my read on this is completely wrong. Is Andy Reid more of a guarded Belichick-type guy than we might realize?
I would say this, and look, this is a lot of pop psychology, which is fun, but I think there's a lot of similarities on both fronts with both. So I would push back a little bit on the Belichick not being a guy you'd want to sit at a bar with and have a beer. Look, I think it's been well documented that the way that he approaches the media and things when it comes to his organization and strategy and all those things is his method. But people I trust say that when you catch him in the right moments and away from the field, and I've had small windows of this, he is as interesting and personable a guy as you'll find. And conversely, I agree. I think Andy Reid would fall into the category of somebody you'd like to sit down and have some wings with and have a few beers and talk football. I just think it's so much is how you package it as a head coach. And a lot of the times, it's funny, I spend a whole season and months on months just listening to press conferences, going to production meetings. And look, there's a value to it, but it can drive you a little nuts because they're all saying around the same thing. It's just how they package it. Mike Tomlin's great at this. I mean, you walk out of a press conference from Mike Tomlin, like, man, that was awesome, because he has a command of the language. But then you look down at your notes and you think, man, I don't know anything about what's going to happen Sunday. So it's like advertising. It's how you sell it.
Hey, my final question is going to be about Patrick Mahomes, because Mahomes is obviously a wonderful talent, but there is something within him where it's easy to follow. I think that veterans don't look at him as a young kid anymore. I think they look at him as their leader. I don't know if it's composure in big spots. I don't know if it's a maturity, but when you see Mahomes or you hear him speak, what makes it so easy for him to lead at such a young age?
Well, I think because it appears that he is comfortable in whatever room he's in. If he's in an offensive meeting room with Eric Bieniemy and Andy Reid, and they're really seriously going over the nuances of a game plan, he can hang in that language and have that conversation about the mechanics of putting together a play and a game plan and some real high-level football IQ conversations. But then equally, he could walk down the hallway and step into the training room with a bunch of 20-somethings and talk about Fortnite or whatever these guys are doing away from the field. And, I mean, he seems – and he's comfortable. It's not an act. No part of Patrick Mahomes is, I read this book about what leadership's about, and I should say this in post-game interviews. I should say this to my teammates in big moments. It all kind of just exudes a comfort, and he doesn't at any point seem to be putting on – a show. And then what it really comes down to, and DA, you know this covering sports as long as you have, it is all washed away by performance. And whether you're a guy that doesn't connect with the locker room or can't hang in those offensive meetings, if you take the field and you make the plays that he often makes, all that good's thrown out the window. He just seems to be the perfect marriage of all those things, which makes him such an exciting talent for Chiefs fans, for for the NFL as an organ, as a business, for us as a network that has the AFC, and I'm sure loves the idea of showing Patrick Mahomes games for the next however long we have the NFL. I mean, that to me is what makes Mahomes special, is that it's not just the performance on the field. It's that he can seemingly be comfortable in all these different areas, and it's natural. And that, and again, my opinion, having been around a lot of these young athletes, is rare.
That's a good read on that. Evan Washburn is going to be handling the sideline duties alongside Tracy Wolfson as part of the AFC Championship game coming up for CBS on Sunday. Let me just tell you this. Two things to watch out for when Evan is on your TV screens. Number one, it is really hard to do good broadcasting when it's really cold because naturally blood rushes to your extremities and not to your brain. So it's hard motor skills-wise to speak fluently and coherently. I know this, so watch that. If Evan ends up messing up, you realize that's just because it's really cold out and he has no control over his brain. Number two, hair is going to be crucial on a frozen day. The great thing is you don't need as much hair product. Your hair is beautiful as it is, but it'll freeze in place. So that's a good thing.
There you go. I mean, I walk away from this learning something, and I appreciate that. You're right. That the frozen jaw is a challenge, and it almost sounds like we've had a few during the game. That's not the case.
It's true.
You can't combat the fact that, and especially when you're doing sidelines, there may be a 15 to 20 minute window where you're not talking, and things can get a bit locked in. But we have our methods to try and combat it all. So we'll see if we can do that Sunday.
Sideline reporting is a game of will, and we'll see as Evan withstands the cold. Thanks, buddy.